Good afternoon to everyone today. Thank you for being here for our August the 11th media update on COVID-19. My name is Ron Aiken. I'm the Media Relations Director for DHEC. We'll start off with an opening statement for Dr. Linda Bell, the state epidemiologist, and followed by the answering of pre-submitted reporter questions and then a live Q&A. Dr. Bell, thank you so much for being here with us today, and I'll turn it over to you.
Good afternoon, Ron. Good afternoon, everyone. Give me just a minute to get my system up here and my camera working. Just bear with me, please.
No problem.
All right, great. Thank you, everyone, and good afternoon. Just checking to make sure my audio is okay. I've been having some issues. I apologize.
We can hear you just fine, Dr. Bell.
Thank you. Good afternoon, everyone. As your state epidemiologist, and I have seen this is an area that I have studied for my entire career, disease control and prevention, and I want to bring to you today that I have never been more concerned about the health of our state than I am at this time. And I say this for several reasons. First being that the COVID-19 pandemic is reaching heights that South Carolina has only experienced once before in January, our apex to this date. Our epi curves are showing that we're currently experiencing the second highest rate of newly daily cases, and the curve is sharply trending upward. Our 36 counties are at high disease activity levels based on the 2-week incidence rates. And according to CDC, our entire state is currently experiencing a high level of transmission of COVID. So in a matter of 3 weeks, COVID-19 hospitalizations statewide have tripled, and most sobering and tragic of all, as of today, our state has lost more than 10,000 lives to this daily disease. So 10,007 South Carolinians who were loved by their family and friends are no longer with us. And a majority of these deaths could have been prevented had all of the infection prevention tools at our disposal been consistently adopted. So it is difficult for me not to get emotional as I think about the number of 10,000 lives lost and how so many of those lives have been changed forever. How many other lives have been changed forever because of this virus? I will say that a few short weeks ago in mid-June, we were seeing days when our COVID cases reported to us were only in the double digits. And at that time, I was very hopeful that we were finding our way out of this pandemic. But as cases began to surge, I hoped that our state wouldn't see another terrible milestone. But unfortunately, instead of these double digit cases, we are now seeing thousands of cases per day. Some in our nation and our state are making choices now that are causing us to lose a battle against an infectious disease for which we have the weapons to prevent. More than 10,000 people have lost their lives in our state, and more than 45,000 doses of life-saving vaccine have expired and gone to waste in our state. And the juxtaposition of those two facts is really heartbreaking. We know how to end this pandemic and how to save lives. We know that the COVID vaccines are plentiful, they're easily accessible everywhere in the state, and anyone 12 years of age and older should get vaccinated immediately in order to get full protection as quickly as possible. What we're monitoring now is the fact that the Delta variant of this virus is hypotransmissible, but the available vaccines are effective in preventing severe disease from COVID-19. However, with the high rates of disease, there's an increasing risk of the emergence of new variants that the current vaccines may not work against. So at this time, we are at a public health crisis, and we have to stop transmission now. We must take action now. It previously seemed unimaginable, but we could soon be seeing 5,000 or 6,000 cases a day if we do not do more now. I'm greatly concerned that this school year could be a perfect storm for disease spread if we have unvaccinated and unmasked students and teachers together. In fact, in 1 week alone, we have confirmed 68 cases of COVID-19 among students and 17 cases among school employees. And that's with only a handful of schools that have students and faculty on campus. The first day of school hasn't even begun yet for the majority of our school districts. We know a lot more about COVID-19 today than we did a year ago. We know, devastatingly, that the most prominent of its variants, the Delta variant, is making more young people sick. And it's making them sicker for long periods of time from long COVID syndrome. We know that a person infected with the original strain would spread it to maybe one or two people, but the Delta variant, with one individual infected, can spread it to as many as 5 to 8 people. This can put unvaccinated and unmasked students and faculty, including at college and universities, at great risks. We know that masks and vaccinations work, yet too many people are not using these tools. So please, I implore everyone to help our children and their incredible teachers to have a school year that they deserve. We want our students and teachers to be in person in safe classrooms where they can thrive, and we know the measures needed to make that happen. So please get vaccinated. We ask everyone to follow credible sources of information to help encourage your family and friend and your family members, your friends, to get their shots. We ask you to talk to your church members, to your coworkers, to your classmates, and share only factual information about why getting vaccinated is the only way to return to normal. Waiting longer to consider whether or not to get vaccinated will have a significant cost for more people. It will have a significant cost for our schools, for our hospitals, and our communities. We are heading in the wrong direction right now, and we're heading there quickly. So the time is now, if we want to move in the right direction, to take the right actions. I thank you all for your attention this afternoon, and I will I'll go to questions whenever you're ready, Ron. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Bell. I'm ready. Our first question today is, are DHEC officials hopeful more people will get vaccinated following full FDA approval of the vaccines? And what message does DHEC have for people waiting on full FDA approval before getting their vaccine?
Well, we are hopeful that more people will get vaccinated, because we know that some people are saying that that's exactly what they're waiting for, that final FDA approval. But what most people don't understand is that the vaccine development and the clinical trial process for vaccines that are under emergency use authorization versus full FDA approval are essentially the same thing. No vaccine can receive either designation of emergency use authorization or full FDA approval without meeting the same rigorous scientific standards for safety, for effectiveness, and for manufacturing quality. So the major difference for full approval, it has to do with the FDA's requirement to require more substantial information about the effectiveness of the vaccines. EUA authorization has nothing to do with vaccines having met the FDA criteria for safety. And we want people to understand that now, if they are waiting for that full FDA approval to be vaccinated. The safety of the vaccines has already been established by the FDA.
Thank you, Dr. Bell. Have there been any changes to the PCR threshold since the start of the pandemic, and whether that would impact the number of cases we're seeing?
I don't quite understand what's meant by the question of PCR threshold, and so we may have to get back on that one. If they're referring to what we consider to be a cycle threshold, the number of times that an isolate is run through, say, the cycling machine to look at the amount of virus that's present, we consider that the cycle threshold. And if that's what the question is about, our methods for PCR testing by our public health laboratory have not changed since the start of the pandemic, but I must say that I'm not familiar with what a PCR threshold is.
Our next question is South Carolina seeing a substantial increase in the number of people getting vaccinated amid the surge of Delta variant cases?
Since July 1st, 2021, the percent of individuals with at least one dose of COVID-19 vaccine increased in South Carolina from 49.7% to 53.9%, and that is a percentage increase of 8.5%.
Our next question is, how many breakthrough hospitalizations and deaths have been recorded in South Carolina from May 1st to the most recent date available?
The information regarding breakthrough cases between May 1st and August 4th, DHEC has reported that there have been 213 hospitalizations and or deaths due to COVID-19 among fully vaccinated South Carolina residents. We've reported that to the CDC. And among those 213 breakthrough cases, 208 of those, or 98%, hospitalizations, and 31, or 15%, deaths occurred among those individuals.
Our next question is, we heard that pregnant women are being hit hard by the recent surge and requiring hospitalization. Do you have any information to support that hospitals are seeing more pregnant women with COVID than earlier in the pandemic? And is there any data to suggest pregnant women might be more vulnerable to or suffer more severe symptoms from the Delta variant than past strains of the virus? And if so, why might that be?
Well, yes, we have providers in South Carolina who care for pregnant women who have given numerous anecdotal reports of their pregnant patients with complications from COVID. And national data supports this as well. And for these reasons, COVID-19 vaccination is recommended for women who are pregnant, for women who are breastfeeding, for women who are trying to get pregnant or who might want to become pregnant in the future, because it has been demonstrated that pregnant and recently pregnant women are more likely to get severely ill with COVID-19 as compared to non-pregnant people. So since we are currently having a pandemic of unvaccinated people, any pregnant woman who is unvaccinated is significantly more vulnerable to complications should she get COVID-19. And I would add that the American College of Obstetrics and Gynecology has issued a statement recommending that all pregnant women be vaccinated, advising all providers to let their patients know who are in those categories of pregnant, wanting to become pregnant, or recently pregnant, that they should be vaccinated because of the substantial increased risk to them for severe disease.
Thank you. Our next question is, what can you tell us about the Lambda variant?
The Lambda variant is a new variant. It was first identified in Peru, where in that country it is now the dominant strain. It was first identified in the United States the last week of July. Currently, the CDC does not consider the Lambda variant to be a variant of concern or a variant of interest, so DHEC is not tracking the number of cases attributed to the Lambda variant at this time. We are aware of emerging reports suggesting that the Lambda variant could potentially be more serious than the Delta variant, and other reports that the current COVID vaccines may be ineffective against the Lambda variant. This is not yet established. We will continue to monitor this, and we will follow the CDC's recommendations for surveillance of all new variants. Again, I will add, though, that if vaccination rates do not significantly increase in our state and in the country, that the virus could eventually mutate to become a variant that can evade the currently available COVID vaccines. And this is why it's absolutely critical for everyone who is eligible to be vaccinated to get vaccinated as soon as possible to prevent the spread and the possible emergence of new strains against which the vaccine would not work.
Thank you. DHEC has reported what percentage of cases, hospitalizations, and deaths unvaccinated people accounted for in June. Do you have those numbers for July and or August, and has it changed at all?
DHEC will make the information for July available on Monday, August the 16th. That will be posted on our website.
Given the rise of the Delta variant and the prohibition on mask mandates in schools, how concerned are you about COVID-19 outbreaks in schools this year compared to last year?
I'm extremely concerned. I do think that we are likely to see more outbreaks, unfortunately, but we can avoid seeing those outbreaks. I would draw people's attention to the fact that the CDC has published a few studies about coronavirus transmission in schools, and those studies showed that in schools where the mitigation strategies of using masks, of physical distancing, of cohorting students in small groups, practicing the social distancing and quarantining individuals who were found to be contacts or were cases, they demonstrated that there was actually minimal transmission within schools, even in communities where there was high disease activity in the surrounding communities. So we know that if schools and parents are compliant with the CDC and the DHEC recommendations for measures that should be in place in schools, those layered prevention measures, we can avert these outbreaks that we're currently anticipating that will result in substantial disruption in schools if we do not comply with the CDC and the DHEC recommendations.
Though it's still very early and many districts have not returned to classes, is there any data to suggest that a higher rate of school cases is already happening?
There is a suggestion of that. Our online dashboard that reports cases among students and school employees went live yesterday for the new year, and it will be updated on Tuesdays and Fridays. You can view that information on our website. Only a few schools have started their academic year, and we'll be monitoring that closely, but we are already seeing reports of cases that concern us.
Next question is, please provide an update on COVID cases in our state's long-term care facilities. Are these facilities seeing an increase in cases?
Yes, we are also tracking cases among long-term facility residents and staff. You can view that on our dashboard as well. Gives the current numbers. We are receiving reports of an increase in cases being reported among staff in long-term care facilities and also in residents. A greater number of staff had been reported as being positive as opposed to residents. And this emphasizes the importance of vaccinations among both the staffs and the residents within these congregate settings. But we particularly urge staff in these facilities to be vaccinated because they are the source of the introduction of these infections among these residents who are living in these congregate settings. So it's a great concern when we see healthcare providers and staff who remain unvaccinated.
Do we know whether the majority of staff and residents are vaccinated?
Well, when vaccines first became available last December, many of you may remember that South Carolina quickly worked with the CDC to help offer vaccinations to as many long-term care facility residents and staff as possible statewide. And at that time, about 30,000 residents received their first and second shots of the Moderna vaccine, and more than 19,000 staff received their first and second shots. At least two vaccination clinics were held at every long-term care facility in the state. So that was when we began the rollout. We know that there has been turnover in the staff and turnover in the residents, so we need to continue to do all that we can to maintain those high vaccination rates, again, particularly among staff.
Is DHEC considering applying more restrictions to these facilities as cases arise?
DHEC will follow any federal recommendations or requirements for these regulated facilities.
Our next question is it too late to get vaccinated?
I have two ways to answer that question. And I will say that if someone has waited for any reason to be vaccinated, it's never too late to get vaccinated now. I want to advise people that the sooner the better, because depending on the vaccine that you receive, it can take up to 6 weeks before you're considered fully vaccinated and therefore fully protected. But the other way that I would answer that question is that I have seen far too many reports of people who made the decision to get vaccinated only after they experienced a bad outcome in someone close to them. I think we've all seen reports of others who have spoken from their deathbeds about having made a mistake when they chose not to get vaccinated. And so I just my message to everyone is, don't let it be too late. Please get vaccinated as soon as possible.
What is the level of protection after one shot of Pfizer or Moderna?
Well, the level of protection after a single shot varies, but know that you are not considered fully vaccinated after a single dose of a two-dose series, and that you remain at substantial risk if you've only had one shot. So you must get the second dose.
And what is the level of protection after that second shot?
Well, it takes about 2 weeks for your body's immune system to fully respond to the vaccine. And so when you're 2 weeks out from completing the series, the level of protection can be as high as 95% against severe disease, against hospitalizations, and against deaths. That is our ultimate goal in preventing those severe outcomes.
What is the level of protection when you hit fully vaccinated 2 weeks later?
Well, I think it would be the same response to that question. The level of protection can be as high as 95%. And we want people to appreciate that. There's so much focus on the vaccines. They offer high protection. And we want people to be aware of the complications of the disease that these vaccines are preventing.
Next question is, what is the average pace of new COVID-19 vaccinations in South Carolina? And is that number above or below the previous weekly average pace?
Since July 1st of 2021, the percent of individuals with at least one dose of COVID-19 vaccine increased from 49.7% to 53.9%. And that is a percentage increase of 8.5%.
How many pediatric cases is South Carolina seeing?
We have reports for children between the ages of 11 and 20 years old, and they represent 8,683, or 22.3% of the 54,000 cases since July 1st. That fraction has increased from November 2020 to May of 2021, but it has decreased a bit since then.
Can DHEC increase the number of tests that are sequenced?
Well, DHEC is evaluating its capabilities in our public health lab, and we're working to determine the optimal level of sequencing to detect the emergence of new variants.
Next question is, in South Carolina, what is the coronavirus's current RO, and does DHEC have any estimates?
I'll first explain what the RO means, or the R-naught is actually the number in simple language. It's just the number of subsequent cases that we would expect to see from a single individual who's infected with the virus. And DHEC is not conducting independent studies of transmissibility, but we are relying on available data that's being collected nationally to look at transmissibility. And a simple way to explain this, if you looked at, this has been represented in a graphic representation, so not with specific numbers. But what we're able to see is that with the Delta variant, the risk of subsequent transmission from a single individual means that a single individual can infect anywhere from about 5 to 8 other people. When we were looking at the original strain, that number was only about 2 people from a single individual. So you can see the magnitude, the amplification that is resulting now from the Delta variant that is driving our disease rates up so highly and so quickly.
Our next question is, in Israel, a high school that reopened in May and temporarily dropped its mask mandate due to a heat wave experienced a major COVID-19 outbreak. Given research like that around the world, with a lack of mask mandates in South Carolina's K-12 schools this fall, do you expect a significant coronavirus transmission within schools?
Well, as I answered this a similar question earlier, I would say that I see no way around outbreaks in schools with the current track that we're taking. So unless the recommended mitigation strategies, including the widespread use of masks in school, are widely adopted, I unfortunately do anticipate that we will see higher transmission and significant outbreaks in schools. But I want to emphasize the point that if we change the track that we're on, that can be avoided.
Other than getting vaccinated themselves, are there any behavioral changes that parents can make to keep their children younger than 12 safe this fall?
Sure. When we talk about behavioral changes, as adults, I think we all know that behaviors that we've adopted are really difficult to change. And we all know that we should exercise, that we should eat right, that we should not smoke. But once we've adopted a behavior, it's very hard to change. But for this reason, it's important for our children that we ingrain certain behaviors so it's not hard for them to adapt. Children are very flexible. They're ready adapters. And when we consistently show them what's expected of them, then the parents can make a difference. If you tell your children that they must wear a mask to stay healthy, that they must wear a mask to protect their families and to do the things that they enjoy, then this works. I recommend to parents that they find their child a comfortable mask, a well-fitted mask, and the children quickly adjust to this. We've seen this widely in other countries, and the children are very adaptable to the use of masks.
The next question is, has DHEC started to plan for the rollout of booster vaccine doses to provide immunocompromised residents? Can you provide any insight into the expected timeline for that?
Well, DHEC, we will follow the vaccine manufacturer's guidelines for the administration of the vaccines and any federal guidelines for doing so should we come upon a time when booster doses may be recommended. And I will say that our planning and logistics staff are poised to assure that providers will have the vaccine inventory that they need to meet any increased demand.
Is DHEC monitoring the number of state employees that are vaccinated, including teachers, or is that the responsibility of individual districts?
DHEC doesn't track cases and doesn't track the number of cases among vaccinated individuals among state employees, but we do track cases associated with schools, and you can visit our website to see our school cases dashboard that just went live yesterday for this school year, and again, that we'll be updating that information on Tuesdays and Fridays.
Our next question is, if a vaccine becomes FDA approved, could it be mandated like other traditional vaccines students and teachers are expected to have, such as measles?
DHEC does establish the school entry requirements for vaccinations, and when we establish those requirements, we do that very carefully, taking into consideration a number of factors. And those factors would include whatever the communicable disease is under consideration, what threat it poses. And we would also have to take into consideration who is eligible to be vaccinated in a school setting, whether individual doses might be recommended, and those are some of the factors that would be taken under consideration if we were looking at that.
What are DHEC's guidelines for nursing homes in areas with high positivity rates?
Well, fortunately, the age group of 65 and older is the highest vaccination group in our state, and those in long-term care facilities tend to be in that older age group, largely in part to our efforts to vaccinate as many long-term care facility residents and staff as possible. As soon as vaccines became available, we achieved that high vaccination rate. And again, you can find the latest visitation guidance for nursing homes and long-term care facilities on our website. Currently, all facilities are required to offer indoor visitation unless there are three specific scenarios that are occurring at the facility as outlined in that guidance online. The measures are in place to help stop disease spread and to protect the health of the facility residents and the facility staff. And DHEC is continuing its partnership with nursing home facilities across the state to help them implement the recommended infection control practices that will prevent spread in those facilities.
We have two more submitted questions. Is it true that smallpox and polio were eradicated by vaccines, not herd immunity? And might that apply to COVID also?
Well, vaccines having been responsible for eradicating diseases and herd immunity are actually not separate concepts, because we can achieve herd immunity through vaccination combined with natural immunity from natural exposure to disease, but it depends on a specific disease, what we gain from herd immunity from natural infection, because some diseases after exposure, you may confer or you may obtain lifelong immunity from natural infection. And in other diseases, you may be repeatedly infected, like COVID-19. We know that reinfections are possible. That makes vaccination ever more important for us to achieve more sustained immunity. So when we're thinking about herd immunity in COVID, we are relying far more heavily on the need to get high vaccination rates to achieve herd immunity. So the issue of reaching herd immunity from COVID, from natural infection, is not going to help us.
And our last pre-submitted question before we get to the live questions is, combining natural immunity estimates with vaccination rates, are we able to approximate the level of protection in the community?
Well, at this time, the duration of immunity from natural infection from COVID and the duration of immunity from vaccinations is still being investigated. So we still have more to learn on that issue.
All right, at this point, I'm going to open it up. I appreciate those answers to questions from people in attendance. And I'm going to begin with Alicia Neves. I think you had your hand up first. Alicia, going once. If not,
Judy. I forgot to unmute. I'm so sorry.
Sure, no problem.
Thank you. With the rise in COVID cases, do businesses, companies, restaurants need to report COVID cases to DHEC? And if yes, how often are they required to provide this information?
We're not asking businesses to directly report to us. We identify clusters within businesses through our own contact investigations when we interview people and we look at the potential sources of their infections. Has given us the ability to identify clusters of cases within certain businesses, within certain facilities. In other settings, I think you mentioned restaurants, it can often be difficult to identify the source of infection for people who are out and about in the community and may have numerous exposures in the community. It's often difficult to link cases back, say, to a particular restaurant, for example, if someone doesn't know where they might have been exposed, especially if they're not practicing the use of masks in indoor settings. And again, for those who are unvaccinated, those would be individuals at highest risk of being in those settings and being unprotected.
Judy Gatson, welcome. What do you have today?
Thanks so much. Appreciate your time and yours as well, Dr. Bell. I know you've talked about this in your opening statements and even in answering some of the Q&A, but we're getting so many questions from parents who just want to know from you in the most plain spoken language possible, how concerned you are about the lack of ability for schools to enforce public health guidance right now.
Well, I'm very concerned if schools are not able to follow the recommendations for those, what we call the layered protection measures. And if we have to rely on parents, we are hearing from many, many parents who are very concerned about how safe the schools will be moving into the fall. And I share that concern as Judy, thank you, as I spoke to. We have abundant evidence about how we can prevent transmission within schools. That has been documented, it has been published, and the CDC showed that in schools where the widespread use of masks was adopted, schools were among the safest settings in communities. When transmission of the disease in the surrounding community was high, the schools were safe settings. But if we move into the fall, where we remove the practices that were in place that kept those schools as the safest settings, then we will see what we saw in the surrounding communities when those studies were done. And what that was high transmission in communities where Masks were not widely in use. Physical distancing and things like that were not practiced. So the schools will end up looking just like the surrounding communities. When we had those protective measures in schools in the past, we know that we were protecting our staff, that we were protecting our students. And if we can move to those measures again, then the schools will be and can be safe settings. But I remain very concerned if it looks like that's not the path that we're currently on.
Lisa Wiseman, go ahead.
Hi, Dr. Bell. Thanks for the time. The differences between probable and confirmed cases, again, could you go over those working definitions again?
So a confirmed case is one that in which an individual has received a nucleic acid test with a positive result. A probable case is in someone who may be epidemiologically linked to another case, may have symptoms, or has had an antigen test that was performed at a certain period of time that we consider that test to be, that individual to be a probable case based on other epidemiologic evidence.
Diane Lee, what do you have today? Diane? All right, Mary Green, go ahead.
Hi, Dr. Bell. That increase in the vaccination rate since July 1st, does that have the potential to turn around that current trend we're seeing in the increase in cases and hospitalizations in the near future? And if not, what is the point at which the vaccination rate would be enough to reverse the trend?
Well, that vaccination rate has been much slower than we need it to be. It's a help, but we need to get there much more rapidly. So when you ask about the vaccination rate that we need to get to, the coverage rate that we have spoken to in the past to achieve herd immunity was around the range of 70% when we were talking about the original virus strain. Now that we have this hypertransmissible strain with the Delta variant, we're actually we will need to achieve a much higher coverage rate because the vaccine is so much more transmissible. We are likely to see more cases, as I mentioned, how it is spread more readily, infecting more people. So what we're looking at now may be to achieve that herd immunity, to eliminate this pandemic, or to significantly reduce the pandemic, would be around the 80% range. And since it has taken us quite a long time to get to the level where we are now with individuals who are considered to be fully protected with two doses of the vaccine, I just want to again urge people that we need to get there more quickly before we have the emergence of a viral strain that could be resistant to the vaccine, or just simply to prevent the rapid rise in hospitalizations that we are currently seeing, that we can avert these, that we can avert additional deaths. So the faster we get there, the better off we are.
Dr. Bell, Diane's audio is not working, but of course her voice will be heard. Her question is there any legal or other recourse to change the provisos that forbid mask mandates in school, considering those provisos go against CDC and DHEC recommendations and were passed before the Delta variant took hold in the state?
I'm sorry, I can't address any legal recourses that might be possible, but I can speak to the guidance and the evidence that if it is left up to public health officials, to parents and schools, to adopt the recommended guidance, then we should do that while other factors play out. So if we all have within our means to use masks widely in settings where the risk of transmission is high, this is particularly indoors and especially for people who are currently unvaccinated. And again, we are in a position to make choices about being vaccinated, and we must do that as soon as possible if we want to be fully protected.
Julia Kaufman, what do you have today for us?
Hi, Dr. Bell. There was a big push last year to have rapid testing in schools for symptomatic students and staff. But this year, a lot of schools are not offering the rapid testing anymore. Does DHEC know why there's been a pullback from that? And are you worried that might hurt the effort to slow the spread in schools?
Well, I don't know about a pullback from that, but we do understand that the testing in schools involves a lot of logistical concerns. We do have programs at DHEC that are working with school districts who are interested in doing that, and we are providing them information where they can obtain tests if they want to perform those, and also providing information where their community members within those schools can be tested, and different models where this has been done successfully in other jurisdictions. So we're doing all that we can to put schools in the best position to adopt testing whenever possible, because it's very important to identify cases as early as possible who could be asymptomatic and in a school spread, school setting, but result in subsequent spread and far more cases if protective measures, those protective layers are not in place. So school testing is a very important intervention that could help us a lot.
Alicia, do you have a follow-up?
Yes, I just had one more question. Thank you very much. At what point, Dr. Bell, could you see DHEC maybe advising against dining indoors again? I know we've seen directives of if you're doing any indoor activities, definitely wear a mask. Maybe what is the threshold of number of cases to shut down a business, a company, a restaurant?
Well, that is not DHEC's role. And DHEC is not looking to shut down any businesses. What we know is that from the current guidance, there are really safe ways to do a lot of things that we want to do in the communities. So DHEC has already provided the guidance that advises people that we should wear masks when we're in an indoor setting. If we're in a community where there is substantial or high transmission, and at this time, that is pretty much statewide. So in every community, in every county in South Carolina at this time, individuals should be masked up. And this should not harm, we're not conveying this guidance in any way to harm our economy, to harm businesses. We just want people to have the evidence-based guidance that will prevent them from being exposed. Masks work, vaccinations work, and if we adopt those things, our businesses and our communities can operate much more safely and put us all in a much safer environment.
Judy, go ahead, please.
Thank you very much. Dr. Bell, I also want to get the insight and, quite frankly, education that you might share with many parents who are saying it's their choice and that if someone wants their child to wear masks to be protected, they can do that, but they shouldn't force their child to also have to wear a mask. I would just like you to address from a scientific perspective about why that's not why that does not maximize mitigating the risk.
Yes. I guess from a clinical perspective, we do not typically see, I would say, parents making recommendations to a healthcare provider about, what medical treatments that their child might receive. We need to recognize that the use of a cloth face covering is actually an intervention that is used in healthcare settings that prevents the spread of respiratory infections. So it is a medical intervention. And I would ask parents to consider the fact that you should follow the guidance from your healthcare providers. When are there other instances when the parent is making the decision about the treatment that's recommended for a child, the preventive measure that is recommended for a child? We know that the masks work. We know that they prevent the spread of an infectious disease by preventing the inhalation of the respiratory fluids that can cause. So the evidence-based guidance that masks be worn. We know that these masks do not harm children, they do not prevent socialization, and they do not prevent learning. So what they do allow is our students and our staff to be back again in face-to-face learning and all the benefits that that offers. So we want parents to give the consideration to that, to have their children in a safe learning environment with the use of masks and those other layered prevention measures. We don't want to miss the point that there are so many children in our schools now who are under the age of 12 who cannot be vaccinated. And I hope that we will do all that we can to protect those children with other means that are available.
That's our time for the day. We appreciate everybody taking this opportunity to join us on this media briefing. If you have any follow-up questions, you can reach us at media@dhec.sc.gov. But in the meantime, I want to thank Dr. Bell for your time and for everybody else's time today with this briefing.